Hi, I'm Dr. Ann Arnett.
And I'm Dr. Jenny Peisch. We're both clinical psychologists and researchers at Boston Children's Hospital.
And this is Answers Through Research, ADHD. In every episode, we discuss research related to ADHD so that you can use the findings and apply them to your own family. In this episode, we'll be answering a question that we often get from families. Dr. Peisch, what is that question?
Why are there so many children these days who are diagnosed with ADHD?
Great question. I'm so glad you asked. Rates of ADHD diagnoses have indeed increased over the past couple of decades, and this is happening worldwide, not just in the United States. Now, before we talk about why that's happening, I just want to discuss for a second how ADHD diagnoses are made. So when clinicians diagnose ADHD, we gather information from multiple sources, including parents and teachers, for example, and we get a sense of how many ADHD symptoms and what kinds of symptoms a child is experiencing across multiple settings. If a child has enough symptoms and they're occurring across multiple settings, like home and school, for example, then they might get a diagnosis of ADHD. And the word might is important there because there are other things that we consider. One thing that we consider that is very important is functional impairment. So a child only gets diagnosed with ADHD if the symptoms that they're having also interfere with their day-to-day life. So coming back to this question of why ADHD diagnoses have increased over the past couple of years. So there was a study done, and there have been several studies done like this. We'll link them in the links below, that showed that even though diagnoses are increasing, the severity of symptoms has not increased. So this study in particular, this was done by CASDA and colleagues and published in 2022, and they followed two large cohorts of children in Australia, each consisting of at least 4,000 children born in Australia. The first cohort was born in 1999 or 2000, and the other one 4 years later in 2003 or 2004. In that first cohort, the earlier one, by the time the kids reached the age of 13, 4.6% of those children had a diagnosis of ADHD. On the other hand, the later cohort, by the time they were 13, 5.6% of those children had a diagnosis of ADHD. So in the course of 4 years, the rate of ADHD diagnoses increased by 1%, which is actually quite a lot. So the question is, again, why is this happening? Well, the researchers looked a little bit more closely, not just at diagnoses, but also at symptom severity as rated by parents. And what they found was really interesting. Even though the diagnoses had increased, the rates of diagnoses had increased, the severity of symptoms had not. So ADHD symptoms aren't really changing, but more diagnoses are being made. Now, there are several possible explanations for this, but as it turns out, there's one that's the most likely and that accounts for the most of this change, and that is related to functional impairment again. So potentially what was happening is that in 1999, 2000, in that cohort, those kids who had mild or maybe moderate severe symptoms of ADHD, many of them were doing fine in their day-to-day life. They weren't having difficulty in school or with friends or emotionally. Whereas later on, the kids who were born in 2003 or 2004, if they had the same severity of ADHD symptoms, they were more likely to encounter problems related to those symptoms. So in summary, rates of diagnoses of ADHD may be going up because mild or moderate severity of ADHD symptoms is getting in the way of success in today's environment. And this finding has been replicated in other studies, both in the US and in other countries. There are two other potential explanations that do account for some of the differences in rates over the past couple of decades. One is that there's increased awareness of ADHD, so more kids are getting the diagnoses and the help that they need. And the other one is potential misdiagnoses. For instance, anxiety often causes kids to be a little bit inattentive or fidgety, and so this could be misdiagnosed as ADHD. So, Dr. Peisch, how can families use this information to support their kids at home?
Yeah, I think you mentioned some really interesting facts, and I want to sort of expand on two things that you mentioned. The first one pertains to the diagnostic process, and when clinicians are working with a child to figure out whether or not they meet diagnostic criteria for ADHD, they will always have a differential diagnosis in mind. So as you said, they will try to rule out potential other explanations for inattention or fidgeting. So we recommend that parents are thoughtful and thorough when they go through an evaluation process. And that would include, for example, asking multiple caregivers or adults who know your child very well. As Dr. Arnett said, that typically includes parent ratings and teacher ratings, but you can also certainly ask coaches and grandparents or aunts and uncles, as long as they know your child well. And this information, when viewed in its entirety, will help a child psychologist figure out whether the symptoms are due to a true underlying ADHD diagnosis or whether they could be driven by anxiety or a specific learning disorder. The second thing I want to touch on is this idea of functional impairment, so that we can modify a child's environment to support their functioning. And what that looks like is that a child can be set up for success based on their individual strengths. If you know that your child does really well in one-on-one playdates, then as parents, you should probably facilitate those one-on-one playdates. Or if you know that your child will struggle to sit still when you're out eating at a restaurant, be sure to bring books, maybe something to draw with, a Rubik's Cube, or a jokes game.
Great. And what about school?
That's a really good point, because a lot of kids struggle at school because the demands are much higher at school. You're expected to sit still and pay attention. We have actually covered a lot of topics that are relevant to the school setting in prior episodes, so feel free to check out the one on exercise, the one on school accommodations, and the one on social skills training. But definitely we would encourage parents to work closely with the teachers at school to figure out ways to support your child. Movement breaks are fantastic, so making sure that your child moves before school and during school. But just work closely with your school team to make sure that they're set up in an environment that helps them. One thing that's important to know is that these supports might have to change over time. A lot of kids with ADHD struggle in the transition from elementary to middle school, so parents and teachers want to make sure that they also provide the supports and change those supports over time to meet each child's needs.
That's great. Thank you. That's all for today. Reach out to us or find out more by checking out the links below.
We'll see you next time.